Aydin, can you tell me a little bit about smartphone science? What is that?
Yeah, absolutely. I think smartphone science is the integration of smartphones into biomedical engineering and biomedical science, and using these innovations that we've had in these little mobile devices that pretty much everyone has, and taking advantage of all their the little complexities inside, and using them to explore new avenues in science. So over the COVID-19 pandemic, we had the opportunity to work on developing a diagnostic device that detected antibodies in the blood of patients that were infected with COVID-19. And essentially what it was is we were building this test that would detect these antibodies, but rather than connecting our test to a large and complex reader that would be found in a hospital or a large research institute, we decided to build a module that you can attach your smartphone to. And the smartphone, with its internal processor and camera, takes over some of the sensing that's done by some of these more expensive technologies. And so once we were able to run the blood test, you can then use the smartphone to do all the reading and all the sensing, essentially giving you the opportunity to get an output using something as simple as just someone's smartphone.
You talk about this being a global challenge. So how are you getting these diagnostic devices in the hands of clinicians in places like Africa?
That's one of the reasons why we wanted to use smartphones. You have a smartphone and I have a smartphone, and we're sitting here in North America, but across the world, we're now above 50% uptake rates for some of these smartphones all across the world. So these devices really are ubiquitous and they are in the hands of everyone. So if we're able to build some tools that are very modular, small devices that you can hook up someone's smartphone to at a local clinic or a local community center, then we believe that we can drive the cost down of these diagnostics rather than every single person visiting a large hospital or a doctor's office getting an individual test. It's really difficult to predict what the most practical tool is. So oftentimes, people try to develop these really expensive and sensitive tools. And I think a good example is the COVID-19 pandemic. At the beginning of the pandemic, everyone wanted PCR tests because they're extremely sensitive and they give a lot of information. And there's a team here at Mount Sinai that over the pandemic was able to build a blood test that can run 10,000 samples all at the same time. You can only really achieve that with this advance in technology and converging it with the development of these biomedical tools.
Can you talk about what the experience has been like working with, you know, leading researchers at Kraft?
Yeah, it's been an absolute pleasure. I think doing science and building biomedical tools is really difficult, but working with research minds like Warren Chan, my supervisor, and working in a facility like Kraft, where we have experience, where we have tools, and we have knowledge that comes together, makes the process a lot easier and a lot more rewarding.
Milica, there's a lot of great work coming out of the Center for Research and Applications in Fluidic Technology. Your research focuses on cell and tissue engineering. So what does a tissue engineer actually do?
Tissue engineer makes tissues, just like the name says. So it's usually the field that relies on combination of cells and some kind of biomaterials and devices, usually some kind of biophysical stimulation. It could be electrical or mechanical stimulation to create tissues in the lab. And initially, there was a lot of excitement about using these tissues for regeneration. But also people realized that not just using the tissues for regeneration, you could create very useful models for research and for discovery.
So let's talk about organ on a chip. That's a research area that you're leading here at the University of Toronto. Can you tell me exactly what that is?
The name implies there is a whole organ on a chip, but it actually isn't the whole organ. It's usually there will be a tissue or combination of cells that enables you to reproduce certain function of that organ. So definitely, I would say heart on a chip is the most advanced project in my lab out of all organ on a chip projects that I have.
For the average person trying to understand this, what are the implications for organ on a chip research for, say, finding cures for diseases?
There is a lot of excitement right now. If you think about new ways of discovering drugs, obviously there is AI, or artificial intelligence, right? And through AI, people can come up with designs for new molecules that don't exist very quickly. If you can speed up discovery by now introducing some human cell-based models, in vitro models such as organ on a chip or microphysiological systems, that gives you the potential to test these new molecules more quickly.
So what does the future look like for organ on a chip? Where do we go next?
First of all, the way we study new molecules and drugs is already changing, right? And if even if people don't use something they call organ or chip, a lot of them are starting to use 3D tissue culture based on human cells. And those could be organoids or spheroids or microphysiological systems, organ on a chip. So the 3D cell culture that's called tissue engineering is now becoming more mainstream. And so that will really be the success of organ on a chip when it's in every lab everywhere. And it's just something that's available off the shelf and you can order and work with it, because I think it's going to fuel a lot of discovery that way.
So Axel, can you just tell me, you know, where did the idea come from to design a handheld bioprinter?
We had an ongoing collaboration for, by now, probably 8-9 years between our research laboratory here at the university and a research hospital, affiliated research hospital, Sunnybrook Hospital. And initially in our laboratory, we developed an interest to use microfluidic technology create small trenches, small microchannels within substrate materials. And we do that by adapting technologies that were developed in the semiconductor industry. So we used this started to use this capability to convert biopolymer fluids to squishy materials. University came back to basically ask us what's the real world application. A suggestion was made to talk to who's a burn surgeon and work on skin. So after joining so many surgeries, we decided to reconfigure our approach to one from producing floating sheets to sort of an on-site extrusion of sheets using a handheld device. Which basically does not require any transfer.
What are the benefits of the handheld bioprinter?
The benefit is an accelerated wound healing, right? And potentially also better clinical outcomes. So the regenerated skin would be, scarring free, right? And in the future would also have more characteristics compared to a native skin. The capacity to sweat or for pigmentation, right? That can be systematically added. And certainly the technology is not limited to burns. So it's also relevant to chronic wounds.
And where do you see the future of this type of technology going? And how do you want to be a part of that innovation?
The future is to some extent also going to be dependent on progress in stem cell technology. But time will tell, and the progress in stem cell biology has been absolutely breathtaking, so I'm sure it will continue that way. And I'm sure Toronto will keep playing a leading role. And certainly we are, as a group, interested in doing things that haven't been done before, and that is always challenging. It's also much, much more exciting.